So in this video, we're going to look at finishing our rough game of Pig, the dice game Pig, by adding a player class. And then after this video, you still may need to go back and still add a little bit of detail and add a little bit of niceness to the input and output. But this should get your game kind of up and going. So if we think about the player class, what we're doing is we're programming to simulate the function of a sheet of paper. And on the sheet of paper, we have the player's name, and then we have their score underneath. The score that we have underneath would be their banked total. And then we'd have the ability to cross out that bank and then write a new bank. So for our player class functionality, we want to be able to add a player. So it would be to store a name and zero out the bank. We want to be able to add a value to the bank. We want to be able to read the amount that's in the bank. We want to be able to read the player's name. And so it looks like we'll have two main variables. We might add more as we go, but two main variables. One would be the player name, and then the other would be the bank as an integer. So let's add the prototype to our program that's going to do this. So we've got class dice here, and here's main. So let's go in between the two. And we'll build our player class. So remember with the class prototype, it's going to have the semicolon after it. And then usually we'll have these two main areas in our class of private and public. Let's put our variables in private. In our program before, we already were using string, so we have include string up at the top already. And then under public, then we'll build our functions. So we're going to have a player function. Let's build two of these. Let's build a default. We'll use that to create our computer player. And then let's do one where we're going to pass it a string. And the string that we send it will be the player's name. So that'll be for our human player. To add the value to the bank, we don't need to return anything, so that would be return type void. But we would need to receive an integer, so it would have an int in there. Then to get the bank value, it would just be the opposite. It's returning an integer. We don't need to send it a value. And then for our get name, it would return a string. So it'll be return type string. And we're not sending it anything, so it's void. All right, so let's enable the constructors. So remember when you're doing your enabling code, everything goes back to player. So it's going to be player colon colon and then the name of your function. The constructors are not able to do a return. So there's nothing in here. If you have a return type, that goes first before the player colon colon and then the name. So to set up our computer player, we need to do player name. And we'll set that to computer. And then we'll set bank to zero. Now let's build our parameterized constructor. So it's receiving a string. It's going to use an S as a placeholder. We can't do string and then do player name because player name's already defined up here, but we can receive a copy of the string into S, and then we can do player name equals S, and that'll make a permanent copy of the player name. Now let's do the rest of these. So we've got bank. So it would be return type void first, and then player, and then bank, and then int. And then int would be the new value. So I'll just call it addit. You could use a different name if you want. So we're just going to take bank and then we'll add it. The next one would be the get bank, so it's return type int. And that's just going to return whatever's in bank. And then the last part would be get name. This is going to return our player name. Alrighty. Probably should have run it earlier just as soon as I finished the prototype, but I forgot. So let me go ahead and run it now. We'll see if I introduced any syntax errors. And looks like I got something. Let's see. Void bank int conflicts. Oh, okay. So what I'm doing is I'm using the same name here. So I've done int bank, and then I did void bank int as a function. So I just need to use a different name here. So I could call this one bank it. And I made the change down here. So it looks like it's working. So now let's just add it into main and see what all we need to change. So let's see, where are we? We've got to explain the rules. Okay, so we're creating a dice. We might as well just go ahead and create our computer player. So let's do player. And then we'll do computer underscore player. We want to use the default constructor, so we're not going to put the open close parentheses after that one. Now we're explaining the rules. We're setting the goal. We've got the player name now. We're going to go back and later nice that up with the input output. But we could create our player instance, our human player instance here. So let's call this my underscore player, and then we'll send to it the player name. Now notice that we've used player name in main and we've used player name in the class, but both of those are local just to those two areas. So the player name here is not going to automatically transfer up. We have to send it to the class, and then it'll get stored in player name in the class. So we've got player score is 0. Now we've already got that. That's now handled by the class under the bank. So we could just comment that out. Player turns 1, temp total, none of that stuff would change. Now here's something that we could replace. So we're doing player and then player name. You wouldn't have to replace this, but you could do my player dot get name. You might look at that, you might say, that's kind of making my code worse. Well, not necessarily. If you wanted to make this be a game where you have multiple players, then that might make this little code fragment a little more reusable to have it a little more generic like this. We'll talk about arrays and vectors later, and then we'll talk about how we can use those with classes to really make a lot of this code reusable. Let's go down here. Let's see, we've got temp total. So then none of that changes. Your temp total is here, your banked total is. So instead of P score, let's replace this with my player dot get bank. Then we have to do that open close parentheses there so it knows to run the function. Okay, none of this is really changed by the class. Player turn is zero. Okay, so here we're having the class handle this instead of the program, so let's just comment this statement out. And then we'll do bank it. And then the thing that we're going to bank is that temp total. Okay, let's see what else we've got. None of this is really going to change. Now we've got this check to see if we won. So that needs to change. So this will be my player dot. Get bank. And then here's the computers portion. So we roll. And then the computers banking. So what we need to do is change this statement out to handle this with the class. And it's the same thing. We'll do a bank it. And we'll bank that temp total. Let's see. You know, I think I've had an error here because my temp total was set to zero. We did the roll value. So instead of banking temp total, probably should go ahead and either set temp total equal to my roll value. There, or I should have banked roll value. Either way would work. Now, we're not ever really checking to see if the computer is winning. The only way the computer would be able to win would be right as soon as the computer has banked. So why don't we go ahead and build that part in here? So we'll do if computer player get bank is greater than goal. Let's do it greater than or equals. Then we'll say, oops, C win. So then the computer wins. This would just be a single line if. You could also use the open close brace there as well. So let's try it, and we may still have a few things to work out, but let's see if it's working. Okay, so let's see, I've got a syntax error here. So I forgot to put the open close parentheses after get bank. Let's try it again. Okay. So let's say yes and say no. Okay, so rolled, I had a 10 in the temp total, and then the 10 is getting banked correctly. So let me roll again. I lost because it rolled a 1. Let me roll again. And I lost again because I rolled a 1. Let me roll again. So I've got an 8. Let me try to roll one more time. Okay, and then I should be able to do an N. And then now I've won the game, so it's exited out. So this has got your game that's working. It just needs to have some bells and whistles added to it. So for example, after this the end of this while loop, you'd want to go back and print out so if the player wins, then we print out and we can do the myPlayer.getName to keep it more general. And then if we're exiting this while loop, either the player has won or the computer has won. So we don't really need to do an else if, we can just do an else. And then we'll replace this with computer player.getName and then you won. So it's those little things that you'll need to go back and add on your program just to make it a little bit more user-friendly. You'll also want to go back here where we set the goal just to equal 20. Probably want to, after you explain the rules, prompt the user to enter a new goal score. And then that way you could change the amount. Originally, it's played to 100, but when you're trying to troubleshoot a program, that gets kind of tedious to run that many dice rolls. There could be some other little errors in here. As you run it, just try to identify if it's working. Try to run it through and see if you can win. Try and run it through and see if the computer can win. And if you do have any problems, then just print things out at every stage, and that's usually the best way to find your errors. Let's go back and take a quick look at this player class. So this is a very light player class, a very generic player class. We could have built even more functionality into this player class. We could have almost made this player class, if we wanted to, be a pig dice class. And we could have captured a lot of what we have in main up inside this class. So just know that you do have the functionality to be able to do that within a class. But as you're getting used to using classes, you may want to keep them fairly light like this and just let your program kind of interact with them a little bit. And then as you get more familiar with them and more comfortable, then you can put more and more information up in the classes. It does take a little bit more time to sometimes to program with the classes, but I think you'll find that it's a little, once you get used to the syntax, because the syntax is rather challenging. But once you get used to the syntax, I think you'll find that classes make your programs much easier to maintain, a little bit easier to debug because you can very quickly see where the problems are. And then also, again, if you're working on a team with many different people, being able to divide the programming up into, hey, why don't you take main? Why don't you take the player class? Why don't you take the dice class? Chances are, if you do that and you have those really well defined and how they're going to interact with each other, and you've got your prototypes already written, then when you write that enabling code, those three pieces are going to go together well. So, thanks for watching.